Welcome in then to the latest edition of Extra Time. Thank you as always for your tweets. Craig Burley, you look like you're about to leave. What are you doing? Steve Nicol is
Get away, Extra Time.
Frank LaBeouf is with us as well.
Frank's buying, right, breaking news.
What?
Frank's buying Chelsea.
Oh, really, Frank? A drop in the LaBeouf fortune to buy that. Was it 3 billion?
It's that money he's leaving in Luxembourg.
He'll have to sell a couple of Bentleys first.
Yeah, yeah.
A couple of more games of, what was that game he used to play? What do you go to Holland to play?
Marbles.
Couple more successful games of marbles.
Celebrity marbles.
Bosh, your uncle, 3 billion. Chelsea. Bosh.
Stevie, what went wrong with the Chelsea defence, which was so solid at the beginning of the season?
I think when you make changes, it can just upset everything. You know, when you've got a back three or a back four that are comfortable with each other, in tune, you know, you've got somebody in charge, and it just works seamlessly.
Right.
And then you maybe get an injury or a loss of... I mean, just for whatever reason, it changes. It just takes one to upset the apple cart, whether they drop too deep or whether they step out and leave a hole. So it's all about keeping a back line together consistently, and then you'll start getting performances like they gave at the start of the season.
Chilwell out, James out, of course. The big impact on it, Frank, is it as simple as that?
Yeah, it is. It is. I agree with Stevie. I think you need stabilities, you need automatism between the players. And with Chelsea, well, today is not really a good example because some players were resting, but you can see that Saar didn't play well today, put some dangers on the field. Rüdiger is Rüdiger, and I think you can count on him and you have no problem. But you lost Reece James, lost Chilwell as well on the side. Thiago Silva doesn't play every game. Christensen has been injured last week, and you had to play Chalobah. Sorry, and that's what it is. That's what it is. You lose that stability. You lose the feeling that they have between the players if they play week in, week out, and that's why they're less stronger than they used to be.
Craig, how do players cope when a club as big as Chelsea is being sold? Is it easy just to shut the noise and focus on winning games?
I don't know. I mean, that's way above the player's pay grade.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you look, as a professional, you just got to get on with what you're doing.
Right.
Training, playing, getting your golf in. Obviously, and just concentrate and then the weekends and the midweek and the cups. That's for other people. I don't think it's going to have any. I mean, it may have some. It may throw a spanner in the work with any negotiative new contracts.
Yeah, you
contracts.
Think Rüdiger, Christensen? Yeah, those,
I mean,
players.
I don't know if they were. I don't think they are. I think Christensen's going. Rüdiger, I don't know. I think it sounds 50-50. Real Madrid, but say Chelsea were really wanting to push the boat out. You know, new owners coming in, do they want to, you know, so that could compromise that.
The only thing is a play, you probably go, well, if there's new owners, you might bring a new manager, and then where does that leave me?
Right.
I mean, that's about it.
Yeah.
That's about as far as you'll think. Because at the end of the day, when you're playing, you're pretty selfish. You're thinking about yourself, your contract and all the other stuff. So, hey, I like this manager, he likes me. If there's a change of owner, maybe they change the manager. And then that's as far as you go.
Do you agree, Frank?
I do. The main concern for the players is whether they're going to keep the same manager or not. And for the players who are almost sure to play, it's not a problem. Well, of course, they think about the club, especially if they have if they really love the club and they want to stay there. They don't want to see the club dropping in level-wise. But otherwise, it's above them. As long as they have the bank account still open at the bank and they still receive the money, they're ready to play. And then what's going on the field is their only concern.
Stevie, which lower tier side impressed you the most during your FA Cup game history?
York City. We were European champions and we played York City in the third round of the FA Cup.
Right.
And we scraped a draw in the first leg, 0-0, away.
Wow. Now,
it was classic back then. Oh. Pitch was rock hard, there was hay on it. But,
yeah.
But we never, I don't remember us making a chance in the game. We held on for dear life. And they were, I'm going to say second division then, maybe
right.
third. And we were European champions and we were glad to get on the bus and drive home.
You've had both sides of it, though. Obviously, success with Liverpool, but was it Doncaster as well?
Doncaster.
What club? What round was that? You got.
It was the first round. The first time I'd ever played in the first round.
Right.
And we played against a league side. I can't remember the name, but it was fantastic. We had about 250 Doncaster fans supporting us.
Right.
And at the final whistle, we won 1-0, we held on, and they all invaded the pitch, and it was just fantastic. First round.
But a man who's won European Cup, FA Cup, League Cup, that was still a special.
Oh, it's just fantastic.
Yeah.
You know, just like them all, that initial when the final whistle goes, that elation.
Yeah.
It's exactly the same, regardless. Doesn't matter what
really?
The ground is. Aye. It was fantastic. Brilliant.
Where are Ukraine? Which lower tier team?
Barnet.
Wow. Why?
Lowest team in the Football League at the time when we played them. 94. Third round. They were the 92nd, bottom, last.
Wow.
And they should have put us out at Stamford Bridge.
Really?
We were talking about earlier, Dmitry Karin. Dmitry Karin at the time was the Russian number one goalkeeper. Right? He was in his pomp. He was springing about all over the goal for 90 minutes. We were like, what the hell is it? Because we just thought we were going to turn that and win.
Right, and that complacency got you.
Complacency, and we beat them in the replay 4-1, but we should have. Yeah, sometimes these guys are just, it's a one-off for them, isn't it?
Right,
yeah.
It's the magic of the cup.
You can raise the game. It's fair play.
What about you,
I thought I saw a statue of you in Doncaster. That was about a couple of years ago. Just outside the bookmakers.
Outside the pie shop.
I wasn't dressed.
Outside the pie shop.
Yeah. I wasn't dressed as Superman.
Fish and chip shop outside. There's a statue of you eating a sausage supper.
Frank, what about you?
Gravy.
It would be Nottingham Forest we played against, first because it was the home of Trevor Francis for me and all the remember that I have when I was young. And we played, the atmosphere was crazy, the pitch was horrendous. And I remember that free kick from Stuart Pearce, where you know you're in the wall and you say, well, avoid us, please, otherwise somebody is going to be killed, you know, because you know that the power of the shoots and... Well, I think we lost. That was awful. I think they were in the championship, and I think we lost. I don't remember, but that was not a very nice souvenir, a nice memory. I only remember the crazy atmosphere.
It was even worse with Pearcey because he used to take these stupid long run-ups.
Yeah.
Right, and be snorting at the ball on the way, grunting. You see it coming. So you get, you know, you're in the wall, and you got plenty of time. But then he starts his run, so then you got another 3 or 4 seconds to brace yourself for what's coming.
Think about it.
They must hurt though when you get hit by those, don't they?
Yeah. Proper ball.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
like those things are weird to
Yeah, there's a heavier balls as well.
I mean,
well.
Seriously, today.
Oh.
Somebody gets hit with a ball, it bounces like 50 yards away.
Right.
I mean, come on, what is that?
Oh.
Stupid.
Stupid balls. Stupid.
None of this lying behind the wall, drafting excluded.
No, none of that.
Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Craig, do you think Leeds will survive in the Premier League this season under new boss Jesse Marsch?
So Norwich are struggling badly. I think Burnley have got the experience, and the manager's got the experience of trying. And the Veikkausen sounds decent. I think they could. I'm trying to think who's worse.
Norwich are done.
Pretty much.
Right.
I think Newcastle have signed enough players.
Yeah.
They'll be fine. I think Everton should be fine with who they've got, and they could inflict a big damage on Leeds. This weekend, and who? Brentford are getting dragged back in.
Watford can't win a game to save their life.
They got to drop Man United, but I'm not sure.
Right.
I think they're in. If Bamford and Phillips were back, and I think Don had said yesterday, Liam Cooper as well, then I would say decent chance. But they just don't have the players. I'm going to say no. I think they could go.
Really?
They're in a really bad run.
Yeah, I don't see how they're going to stay up with the amount of goals they lose. And the players they've got, they're just not good defenders. And they're not... Sometimes you can get away with having bad individual defenders if you can get them to play together.
Right.
And then they're covering for each other constantly. But this, the group that they've got now, I don't even think they can do that. So they'll lose too many goals. I don't think they'll stay up.
That's it. That's the end of Extra Time. That's the end of the show. Thank you very much for watching. And we'll be back tomorrow. Everton against Boreham Wood, is that?
Boreham Wood.
Boreham Wood against Everton tomorrow. Our feature game on ESPN+. Be sure to check it out. Thank you very much for watching ESPN FC on YouTube. For more highlights, analysis, and exclusive content, be sure to subscribe.